Hello students, so in last lecture we have seen gear shifting mechanism. Okay, this is a gear shifting mechanism diagram. Now in this lecture we will see torque converter, overdrive and types of axles. So torque converter is a fluid coupling device which is used to as a clutch and as a torque multiplier device. This is used in between engine shaft and transmission shaft. Okay. So internal combustion engine creates power by burning fuel that forces the piston to turn the crankshaft located at the bottom of the engine. This rotational force is transferred to the transmission by fluid pressure inside the torque converter. Inside of the torque converter cover lies a series of propeller like blades called pump. So in torque converter there is a pump and turbine part. One impart torque and one accept torque and transmit to the transmission system. This assembly spins in unison with the engine crankshaft, forcing transmission fluid onto another blade assembly called in the impeller. The second set of blade is connected to the transmission input shaft. The amount of hydraulic pressure that it creates inside the transmission dictates the gear and ultimately the speed of the vehicle. So it generally used as a clutch to engage and disengage the power or torque from engine to the transmission shaft. And also it can be used as a torque multiplier to increase the torque. Okay, I will share one elaborative animated animation video of working of torque converter. You must see this video. I will share link of this on the group. Okay, so torque converter, this is the two-dimensional diagram of a torque converter. In this, the left side green side is a part, this is a turbine part, and right side is a part of pump part. Okay, so there is a fluid in between, and due to this fluid this torque converter can be used as a clutch as well as torque multiplier also, and that's so the torque is transmitted from engine shaft to the drive shaft. You must see that see this animation video of torque converter, so you will understand it better. These are the inner part of torque converter. First is impeller, then stator with one way roller sprag, turbine, clutch assembly, front cover. Advantages of torque converter: it multiplies the torque by the movement of oil. All parts are remain synced in oil, hence their wear is less. It transmits power without noise and shock at different speed and torque ratio. Operation is completely automatic and reliable. Generally, servicing of torque converter is not necessary. Construction of torque converter is simple, wear is less due to less effect of slip. So these are the advantages. There is a disadvantage also. The torque available to start the vehicle from rest in first gear reduces with increasing speed of the vehicle. It becomes fluid coupling on increasing speed of the vehicle, hence the torque multiplication stops thereafter. There is no torque multiplication in third and fourth gear, so at higher gear or overdrive. At overdrive condition, torque multiplication does not appear. Reverse gear arrangement of mechanical type is to be used with it. To prevent torque converter from overrunning, a freewheel device is required. So another arrangement of freewheel is required to prevent the overrunning of torque converter. These are the disadvantages. Now, next point is overdrive. Overdrive is a device which is used to step up the gear ratio in the car. So if we require the speed of vehicle above engine RPM, then overdrive device is used. It is a epicyclic gear train. It is basically epicyclic gear train. Okay. See, it is fitted in between transmission and the propeller shaft. It enables a high cruising speed to be attained with a comparatively low engine speed, up to 20-25% of long journey on the long journey. This results in less wear of engine and decreases vibration and noise, as the friction loads at lower speeds is less. There is saving of fuel also with the overdrive. Overdrive is generally fitted on top gear only, but in some sports car, overdrives are also fitted on gears other than the top gear, which increase the torque ratio available. So mostly for if we require speed above the engine RPM, then like a sports car, overdrive gears are fitted. So when, for example, when overdrive is fitted on top third and second gear, 7 forward speed or torque ratio are available. The overdrive may be operated either manually or automatically at predetermined speed. This is a diagram of overdrive. See, this is a epicyclic gear train. On left side, this shaft is input shaft on which sun gear and planet gear, that is pinion, is fixed. The outer casing is see here, this is ring gear, then this is totally a epicyclic gear train. Through splines, free wheel clutch is fitted, and output shaft is fitted through a cover. See, this is the output shaft, and it is fitted through to the ring gear and pinion gear through outer cover. So this is a epicyclic gear train. Overdrive, it consists of an epicyclic gear train in which the sun gear is free to rotate on the input shaft, while the carrier can move on spline on the input shaft. A freewheel clutch is also fitted on the input shaft spline. The output shaft is connected to the ring when the sun gear is locked with the casing. That is, it becomes stationary if the output shaft is increased. That is, overdrive is engaged. When the sun gear is locked to the carrier or to the ring, solid drive through N is obtained. Thus, depending on the locking of the sun gear with ring gear or with carrier, the overdrive or the normal direct drive is obtained. There is another possible control of the mechanism. When the sun wheel is kept free to rotate on the input shaft, in this case there is a direct drive through the freewheel clutch when the engine develops power. So overdrive is basically used to attain higher level of speed. Advantages of overdrive: when car is moving ahead at constant speed, then it doesn't require more power to maintain that speed. Hence, to maintain the speed of car, engine speed can be reduced using overdrive. High speed running of vehicle at low engine speed can be obtained by using overdrive. Fuel consumption can be decreased. The wear of engine and auxiliary unit decreases. Due to reduction in engine RPM, considerable saving of fuel is achieved. For required vehicle speed, engine is running slowly, hence its service life increases. The overdrive can be controlled electrically or hydraulically from dashboard or a switch provided on steering column. So these are the overdrive. Now, as per syllabus, we will see next point, that is axle, types of axle, etc. An axle is central shaft for rotating wheel or a gear. On wheeled vehicle, the axle may be fitted to the wheels, rotating with them or fixed to the vehicle, with the wheels rotating around the axle. Bearings or bushings are provided at the mounting points where the axle is supported. The types of axle are, first is rear axle. In this, full floating, semi-floating, three-quarter floating, there are three subtypes. The second is front axle. In this, dead front axle, line front axle, two subtypes are there. The third is stub axle. In this, Elliott, then reverse Elliott, Lemoine, reverse Lemoine, four subtype of stub axle are there. Now we will see first front axle. Purpose of front axle. Its purpose is to carry weight, facilitate steering, absorb shock. It absorbs the torque applied on it due to braking of vehicle. It is made up of steel drop forging having 0.4% of carbon steel or 1-3% of nickel steel. This is the diagram of front axle. See, the middle part is main axle having I cross section. It is joined by kingpin to this the remaining part of axle. This part is called as stub axle. Okay, the on left side and on right side, these are the stub axles. See, you can see here the diagram of stub axle. Now the second is live axle. Live axle are used to transmit power from gearbox to front wheels. Live front axles although resembles rear axle, but they are different at the end where wheels are mounted. Maruti 800 has line front axle. See, this is a diagram of live axle. Now, next is dead axle. Dead axles are those axles which do not rotate. These axles have sufficient rigidity and strength to take the weight. The ends of front axle are suitably designed to accommodate stub axles. So, dead axles are do not rotate. They only support wheel. They must have highly sufficient rigidity and strength to stand the weight of vehicle, and the ends of front and end of this axle are designed to accommodate the stub axle. Now stub axle. Stub axles are connected to front axle by kingpin. Front wheel are mounted on stub axles arrangement for steering. Stub axles turn on kingpin. Kingpin is fitted in front axle beam and is located and locked there by taper quarter pin. Stub axles are of four types. First is Elliott, then reverse Elliott, Lemoine and reverse Lemoine. Types of front axle. See, first is Elliott. This is a diagram, first diagram, upper left side Elliott, then on right side reverse Elliott, then C Lemoine and D reverse Lemoine. These are the types of stub axle. Now next is semi-floating axle. With a semi-floating axle, the axle shaft both carries the weight and transmits the torque. The wheel is often bolted directly to the flange on the axle. Semi-float axles are seen on cars and light-duty trucks. Semi-float are more limited in capacity but lighter and cheaper to manufacture. Semi-floating axle, the diagram of semi-floating axle. Now the next is full floating axle. The weight of the axle is supported by the axle housing, more specifically a bearing spindle attached to the axle housing and a set of bearing in a separate wheel hub. Torque is transmitted by a separate axle shaft that carries no weight. As commonly built, full floater are considerably heavier but also much stronger. This is the full floating axle. The next is three-quarter floating axle. This type of axle is combination of full and semi-floating bearing. In this bearing is locating between the axle casing and hub axle shaft. Do not have to withstand any shearing or bending action due to weight of the vehicle, which are taken up by the axle casing through hub and bearing. However, it has to take end loads and driving torque. A three-quarter floating axle is same as semi-floating with one difference, that the outer bearing is moved to the outside of the outer end of the axle tube, supporting hub assembly via the bearing outer circumference edge. This is the diagram of a three-quarter floating axle. Now, as per syllabus, see, this is another PPT. Introduction to propeller shaft. Shaft is, as this has to withstand torsional loads, it is usually made up of tubular cross section. It also has to be well balanced to avoid whirling at high speed. Shafts are made of steel, aluminium or composite material. Universal joint. One or two universal joint depending upon the type of rear axle drive used. The universal joint account for up and down movement of the rear axle when vehicle is running. So universal joint is used whenever there is a up and down movement of axle or shaft. It is used to tolerate linear or angular misalignment. Then slip joint. Depending upon the type of drive, one slip joint may be there in shaft. This serves to adjust the length of propeller shaft when demanded by rear axle movements. See, this is the diagram of propeller shaft. These are the in detail components of propeller shaft. Propeller shaft is used as a driving shaft to joint the output shaft of the gearbox with the differential unit in the rear axle. The rotational motion of the gearbox main shaft is transferred to the differential unit for rotating the drive wheels. Mainly torsional load acts on the propeller shaft, hence it is made up of tubular cross section. To prevent the turbulence generation at high speed, it is perfectly balanced. Universal joint is provide to transmit the power at changing angle of the propeller shaft while vehicle is running. Slip joint is provided with the propeller shaft to take care of increasing length of propeller shaft while vehicle is running. Functions of propeller shaft. Propeller shaft take power from gearbox output shaft without making any change in power. It transmits same to the input pinion of the differential unit from where power is transmitted to the drive wheel through rear axle. To accommodate the change in line and level between gearbox output shaft and differential input pinion shaft. construction details of propeller shaft. Now we will see each and every part in propeller shaft. The propeller shaft used to transmit the power from gearbox output shaft to differential with tubular cross section and one or two piece construction. The two piece propeller shaft is supported at the center by rubber mounted bearing. Propeller shaft should be rigid enough to absorb the twisting action due to driving torque and the torsional shock. It should be capable of resisting the vibration. Construction details of propeller shaft. Tubular propeller shaft is generally used because it weighs less as it is hollow shaft. It can resist misalignment. It has a good torsional strength. It provides less resistance to change of angular speed caused when hook type coupling is used. Propeller shaft is running faster when overdrive is used. Hence, it should be produced as per required design specification and good limit of balances. Now, vibration produced in the propeller shaft. Vibration of propeller shaft. The vehicle having bigger wheel base need long propeller shaft. Long propeller shaft generated whirling by bending at its center. We have seen that a long beam has a prone to whirling. In such condition, resonant vibration are produced in the body. Hence, along with the whirl, vehicle body also vibrates. For resonant frequency of propeller shaft, there are two groups of main factors producing vibration. The first one is factor related to propeller shaft and factor related to vehicle body. Now, the vibration of propeller shaft. Factor related to propeller shaft. Shaft diameter to length. Shaft diameter and length. Then balancing of assembled shaft and joint. Bending resistance of the shaft. Factors related to vehicle body. In this, shape and type of body structure, location of body structure part, engine transmission mounting, spring, bushing and pinel insulation by clamping quality for drive shaft vibration. So these are the, now next point is universal joint. A universal joint allows driving torque to be carried through two shafts that are at an angle with each other. So, if there is an angle in between their two shafts, that is, two shafts are not in one axis, then in between there should be a joint which effectively transmit motion, and that joint is universal joint. A simple universal joint consists of two shaped yoke. One of the driving shaft and the other on the driven shaft. The four arms of spider are assembled in needle bearing in the two yokes. The driving shaft and yoke force the spider to rotate. The other two trunnion of the spider then cause the driven yoke to rotate. When the two shafts are at an angle with each other, the needle bearing permit the yoke to swing around on the trunnion with each revolution. This is the universal joint. You must have seen this universal joint. The outer part is called as yoke. On this shaft is provided, and there is a cross piece is in between. See the diagram carefully. A universal joint is a simple universal joint does not transmit the motion uniformly when the shaft are operating at angle. Because of this, two universal joints are used in vehicle, one between the gearbox and other between propeller shaft and the differential pinion shaft. So, by using two universal joints at a time, there is a uniform distribution of motion can be acquired. Next point is constant velocity joint. Constant velocity joint, also known as CV joints or homokinetic, allow a drive shaft to transmit power through a variable angle at constant rotational speed without an appreciable increase in friction or play. They are mainly used in front wheel drive and many modern rear wheel drive car. With independent rear suspension, typically use CV joint at the ends of the rear axle half shafts and increasingly use them on propeller shaft. Constant velocity joints are protected by a rubber boot, a CV gaiter, Cracks and splits in the boot will allow contaminants in, which would cause the joint to wear quickly. This is a constant velocity joint. Now, next is a slip joint. Slip joint is attached to the driven yoke in order to increase, or decrease the length of propeller shaft. It has outside spline on the shaft and matching internal spline in the mating hollow shaft or yoke. When assembled, the splines causes the shaft to rotate together while they can move back and forth. This changes the length of the propeller shaft. This is a slip joint. This is a diagram of a slip joint. So here our lecture ends. In next lecture we will see next point. The next lecture will be last lecture for module number 1. Thank you.